here's my 2007 MacBook. It's a wonderful little machine, even though it's well past its prime and is obviously no longer supported by Apple. The latest version of Mac OS that will officially run on it is 10.7.5, which is what I have running on it now. You can see it has a 2.2 GHz Intel Core 2 Duo processor and 4 gigs of RAM. And lately I've been using this for my CD ripping project, which has been going along just fine. So far I have just under 500 CDs imported into this machine, although not all of them were ripped with this machine. Some of them I ripped on my 2008 MacBook Pro. I shared some of the duty with that machine as well as this one, but I copied all of them into this one because that's where the collection is going to reside. So that's been going along just fine, and it's gotten me more interested in seeing what I can do with this old machine. There's a lot of software that runs perfectly fine on this old version of Mac OS. For example, the latest version of Audacity runs fine, even though it no longer supports Windows XP. Here you can see it's running Audacity 2.3.0, which is the latest version as of when I'm making this video. And a lot of utility type software runs fine as well. For example, the latest version of CCleaner. And I have this fan control program here called SMC Fan Control, which is very useful because if you're doing something processor intensive, like encoding video, you can kick up the fan to a higher speed so that avoids it from cooking the processor by keeping the fan at a lower speed than it really should be, which is something that Macs tend to like to do. I guess because Steve Jobs was always against fans and computers. He didn't want the noise that they generated. So in something like this, which was made when he was still around, they kept the fans purposely at a lower speed than what they really should be. So it's useful to have something like this where you can kick them up to a higher speed when you know you're going to be doing something processor intensive. There's also Coconut Battery, useful program for determining the remaining life of your battery, which in this case is nothing. You can see 0 milliamp hours. The battery in this thing is totally gonzo. I don't think it has ever worked as long as I've had this machine. I bought it in 2012, and ever since then it hasn't had a working battery. But you can see if I do check for updates, it'll tell me I'm using the newest version of Coconut Battery, so that still works fine. As for productivity type software, the newest version of Microsoft Office they'll run in this version of macOS is Office 2011. I have Office 2008 installed on this and it runs fine. As for LibreOffice, the latest version does not run on this version of macOS. The latest version that will run is 4.3.7.2. which is what I have installed here. Although the latest version of OpenOffice will run on this version of macOS. Even the latest version of Adobe Flash Player runs fine, even though on their website they claim it requires at least macOS 10.10. You can see I have the latest version, 32, running fine in 10.7.5. But one of the sticking points of being able to use this old version of macOS on a daily basis is the lack of a modern web browser. The latest version of Apple's own web browser, Safari, that supported this version of the operating system was way back in 2014, and it no longer works with a lot of websites. I think YouTube still works to some extent, although it gives you a warning that it's no longer supported on this browser. I discovered that Discogs doesn't work for some reason. Just says Safari can't open this page. The last major web browser to support this version of macOS was Firefox with their extended support release, version 45.9. But it says right here, you cannot perform further updates on this system because this was the last version they supported. And it still works with most websites perfectly fine, but at some point it's going to run into the same kind of problems that was just showing with Safari. So I was glad to recently discover a new web browser that supports macOS 10.6 and later. It's available in 32 and 64-bit versions for Intel processors, so unfortunately PowerPC users are left in the dark, but those machines haven't really been usable on the web in quite a while, so that's no surprise. But here it is, Arctic Fox version 27.9.12. It says it's up to date. It's a fork of the Pale Moon browser. And it says the intent is to add security updates and bug fixes to keep this browser updated for as long as possible. So this is a modern web browser with all the latest security updates and bug fixes for this old version of macOS. And it works with pretty much everything I've thrown at it so far. Works perfectly fine with YouTube. You can tell I've been watching a lot of Bob Ross videos recently. Twitter works fine. Facebook works fine. You think you have a lot of computers? Check out that stack of old desktop PCs there. Looks like they're selling them for $100 each. eBay works fine. There you can see all the items I've been looking at recently. Reddit works fine, although I'm using the old layout because I highly prefer it compared to the new layout. Amazon works fine. And Wikipedia works fine, although it usually works fine even on older web browsers, so that's no surprise. So if you have a Mac that's still running an older version of macOS, and you've been looking for a more modern web browser for this, I would definitely recommend giving Arctic Fox a try. I'll include a link in the description where you can download it. Although I think they should come up with a better rendition of their logo, because that kind of looks like a fox that has frozen to death. So I think they're taking the name Arctic Fox a little too literally. Actually, I take that back about it not supporting PowerPC, because according to this thread in the Mac Rumors forum, it looks like somebody created a custom version of Arctic Fox for 32-bit PowerPC Linux. So if you're a PowerPC diehard that's running Linux, you can also check out this web browser, see how well it works for you. There's also a custom build of the Pale Moon browser for Windows XP. There's a thread about it on the MSFN forum if you want to give it a try. I've been using it on my Windows XP machines and it runs perfectly fine. All these same websites you can see running here work perfectly fine in this Windows XP version as well. So that's worth a try if you're still using XP on any of your computers. So it's nice to see people coming up with new ways to keep old computers useful. And if you know of any other new software designed to run on older computers and older operating systems that you think is useful, feel free to share it in the comments.
If I see anybody with a 20-foot scarf on the train, I'm gonna strangle you with
it. Yeah, or step on it as you walk away and watch you get pulled back.
Yeah, what building did you climb down from?
Rapunzel. Can we please cut it out with umbrellas during snowstorms? It's not cute anymore.
You look like a real idiot when it flies inside out and you try to look cool.
Yeah, and then you got spokes shooting at your eyeballs on 18th Avenue. I don't need to see that.
Amen.
And to everybody with the smartphone posting screenshots of the weather. Yeah, we know it's cold and snowing.
And to everybody posting screenshots in hot weather. I'm gonna
live forever. And here's one CD I won't be ripping on my Mac. It's the CD Santa Claus. I found this in TJ Maxx when I was doing my holiday shopping. It's actually made in Germany. And they got it pretty close to the size of a regular CD jewel case. Dimensions are pretty much exact. In fact, it'll even fit in the standard slot in a CD rack. And it's just slightly larger in diameter than a standard CD. Maybe half a millimeter. But you notice the center hole is much larger, and it's also quite a bit thicker. So let's see, does it fit in a standard jewel case? Can you close it? Yes, we can. But if we take a standard CD and try to put it in the tray the chocolate CD came in, it doesn't fit because the center hole is not big enough. And I bet you're wondering what would happen if I put this into a CD drive. Well, let's take care of that right now. Take our chocolate CD, put it in the drive. Kind of got hung up a little bit there. Obviously, he's not going to be able to try to read it because it's not the proper size of the center hole, but let's see if I can get this thing open again. Almost. So, hopefully no harm was done to either the chocolate CD, which still should be perfectly edible, or my CD-ROM drive. Yep, tastes like chocolate.